Well, good morning, church. Good to see everybody here today. One of you already got it. Go ahead and stand up and let's worship together. Sing it.
When you found me, I was so blind. My sin was before me, I was swallowed by pride. But out of the darkness, you brought me to your light. You showed me your mercy and opened up my eyes.
Worship the Lord, to lift our praises to Him, to sing of the joy that He has given us through Jesus Christ. And so glad that you're here, especially our guest. Maybe some of you are back today after being here last Sunday as your first time at Linwood. And so we welcome you back. We're glad that you're here. And hopefully you'll see that, you know, pretty much what we did last week is going to be the same thing today. And that you'll feel comfortable worshiping the Lord here in this place. For those who are first-time guests, if you've not filled out a guest card, then you'll find that in the seat in front of you. If you'll fill that out and then place that in the offering plate later in the service as your gift to us this morning, we'd appreciate you doing that. We've got a very exciting service in store. We've got several things that we're going to be doing. Baptisms, it was great to do that. By the way, tomorrow, Miss Frances Toole, her 90th birthday. Can you believe that? 90 years. You might have seen her in the foyer with her entourage, her family, her extended clan was here in the first hour. And so if you see her, you'll want to encourage her, maybe write her a note. She's a great lady, and she's been so faithful, and she's fed us so well here at our church. Amen. So you'll want to encourage her, all right? And that's one of the wonderful things about being a part of the body of Christ, is to be able to encourage one another and to let others serve us. And she did that so faithfully, and still doing it. God bless her. Well, right now, let's stand. Let's greet those who are near us, especially our guests.
Morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us. It's Sunday, April 23rd, and here's what's going on. Our church will celebrate parent-child dedication on Sunday, May 14th, Mother's Day, during both morning worship services. This is the first step in the milestone strategy. If you're the parents of a young child and would like to participate in this meaningful ceremony, please stop by the family check-in area or contact Kevin Coffey at the church office. All parents who participate in the dedication service must first complete the Giving My Child to God class. This class will be offered Sunday, April 30th at 5:30 p.m. or Wednesday, May 10th at 6 p.m. Come celebrate for us with us for what's sure to be a very special Mother's Day. Join us for a trip to the Ark Encounter in Williamstown, Kentucky, and the Creation Museum in Petersburg, Kentucky, October the 4th through the 7th. All ages are welcome, and you don't have to be a member of Linwood to participate. The trip will include your choice of the Louisville Slugger Museum or Fraser History Museum in Louisville, Kentucky. Cost is based on room occupancy and includes charter bus transportation, 3 nights lodging, admission to 3 attractions, and 7 meals. Please visit linwoodbc.org/senioradults for more information, including cost, itinerary, and a registration form. Brochures are available in the foyer. Registration forms and deposit payments are due by May 21st. The National Day of Prayer is an annual observance held on the first Thursday of May, inviting people of all faiths to pray for the nation. It was created in 1952 by a joint resolution of Congress and signed into law by President Truman. This has great significance for us as a nation because it enables us to recall and teach the way in which our founding fathers sought the wisdom of God when faced with critical decisions. This year, Cape First will be hosting on May the 4th from 7 to 7:30 a.m., and we invite you to join us as we pray for our nation. In October of 2018, you'll have the opportunity to join us for a trip that is nothing short of a life-changing experience, Israel. You'll have the opportunity to walk in the footsteps of Jesus Christ. This is not a mission trip, but it is an opportunity to immerse yourself in the Israeli culture as you experience food, traditions, music, and biblical history of one of the oldest nations in the world. I had the opportunity to go last year, and you can take it from me, you don't want to miss out on this opportunity. You'll never read the Bible the same way again. There will be an informational meeting on April 30th at 4:30 in the choir room. I sincerely hope you consider joining us on this trip. I can guarantee you, you will not regret it. You might also try checking out Right Now Media and searching for a video series entitled Experience the Land of the New Testament by Brian Harden. This video features over 30 short videos taken from the Promised Land series that highlight locations all over Israel, including some of the stops we'll be making on the trip, from Bethlehem to Galilee, Masada, and for me, the best of all, Jerusalem. It's a great way to get a taste of what you'll get to see in person. So hop on rightnowmedia.com, click on Libraries, then click on Linwood Baptist Church. Again, the series is entitled Experience the Land of the New Testament. It's amazing. I highly recommend it. Check it out. And as always, for more information on these announcements and much more, jump on linwoodbc.org or check out the new app. And if you're a guest with us this morning, feel free to drop by the guest services desk out in the foyer for your free gift. And welcome to Linwood.
For those who are guests, one of the things that we often like to do is to have people who are part of our church share what God's doing in their life. That may be somebody who's gone on a mission trip, a short-term mission trip to somewhere here in the States or around the world, but also what God's doing in a person's life currently and how he's changing their life and he's encouraging them and helping them. We feel like that really is a key of helping people understand the reality of our faith. The reality of our faith is not what we know, it's how we live. It's the transformation that we experience. And we've asked Don Moore to come and share his testimony with you about what God is doing in his life. So let's welcome Don Moore. All right, Don, share with us, brother. God bless you.
Good morning. My name is Don. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, and I struggle with alcohol and insecurity. I've been asked to make some brief comments on my struggle with alcohol and how God has used Celebrate Recovery in bringing me back to a full and rewarding relationship with Him. Now, I'll make it brief. Like the old saying goes, brevity is the soul of wit. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, I don't think our pastor has ever heard that old saying. Can't really do anything about that. I'll keep it short. I trusted Jesus Christ as my Savior on Lord and Savior on July 4th, 1979, at the age of 22. Prior to that, I had already developed a problem with alcohol. But when I was saved, I stopped drinking completely. In my mid-40s, due to some issues, I started drinking again, gradually at first. And at first, it was not much, but it continued to grow over the years to the point that if I was not going to work, I would drink over a fifth a day, and sometimes two-fifths a day. After two DWIs, one hospitalization detox, and two stints at rehab centers, I heard some good news, some good things about Celebrate Recovery. I had already wanted to recommit my life to Christ, and I believe it was He who led me to Celebrate Recovery. Now, I'm not here to tell you that Celebrate Recovery in and of itself is anything. Just like there's nothing in and of itself is anything, but Celebrate Recovery with Christ as the center is very special, and it has been wonderful to me. It has helped me in my road back to a strong relationship with the Lord, and I can't wait for Tuesday evenings to roll around so I can attend CR. The first thing I noticed about CR when I came was how refreshingly real it is. Refreshingly real. Unfortunately, that's lacking in many of our churches today. Real people were being completely honest about the real issues in their lives. One verse you will hear each Tuesday if you come to Celebrate Recovery is James 5:16. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. I'll tell you that confessing our sins to one another, folks, that command from James is followed at Celebrate Recovery. From the highest in leadership to the lowest level, everyone is honest and confesses. It is refreshing to hear people obey God's directive when it is not easy to do so. And for me, there is real healing and freedom in confessing my sins to someone else. As I said earlier, it's kind of funny because I volunteered at the Franklin Graham's 50-state tour this past summer in Jefferson City. And one of the first things he told the audience to do was to confess their sins to the person beside them. Total strangers, but we're told to confess. He told them to confess our sins to the person beside us. Billy Graham did the same, I believe, in his crusades. I once heard Billy Graham, or I might have read it, but he had an issue that he struggled with. Evidently, when he did crusades, women, Christian women, would try to seduce him. He said that the temptation was very real in him, and he struggled with it. So made it a point to call his wife every evening of a crusade to keep him from slipping into adultery. Folks, if the most preeminent evangelist of our time can confess his struggle, why can't we? Confessing our sins also holds us accountable to those we confess to. That may be why Billy Graham relayed openly the temptation in his life, so this temptation or this struggle would not turn into fruition. He was more afraid of sin than what people thought about him after he told them about his struggle. As obedient followers of Christ, we are called to be obedient even when it is hard to do so. In fact, that is true obedience. When you were a child, when were you obedient to your mother? When she told you to eat cake? Or when she told you to eat your broccoli? Adam showed his obedience by disobeying God when it should have been easy to obey. Jesus showed how obedient he was by obeying God when it was unimaginably hard. Hebrews 5:8 says, although he was a son, he learned obedience from the things which he suffered. Philippians 2:8 said, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Jesus was obedient even when it was difficult. In obedience to God, let us confess our sins to one another. There is a religion in our churches across the land. It is very destructive, and it leads, in my opinion, to defeated Christians. You might come to church or to a church meeting and say, I don't have any hurts, habits, or hang-ups. Don't smoke, drink, or chew, or go with girls that do. You might say that. You might say that, but the cold, hard reality is that we all have issues. I went to great lengths to hide my issue. The only thing that did for me was to keep me enslaved to alcohol longer. By acting the perfect Christian, we not only don't get the brotherly help we need from other Christians, we also discourage others from seeking it. Don't be that stumbling block that inhibits others from following the commandments in Scripture. You might say, what will people think if I confess my sins? I will be judged. And I hear you. You might be judged. There might be those who, instead of praying for you, would judge you. If you, those people that judge you, when they hear your sins, aren't going to pray for you. But the truth is, they aren't going to pray for you when you don't confess your sins, so you've lost nothing. But there are people who will pray for you. Unfortunately, in the church as a whole, we have done a pretty poor job of caring for our wounded brothers and sisters in Christ. It ought not to be that way. But I guarantee you, you will not be judged at Celebrate Recovery. You will be listened to by compassionate Christians, prayed for, helped on your way to a victorious walk with Jesus, with the Lord Jesus Christ, and you're going to enjoy some mighty fine dinner and dessert. Now, your big issue may not be sin, but a hurt that has affected you for years. You know you need a release from the pain, but you don't know how to gain victory with it. At CR, there is a wide gamut of issues that have caused pain to believers, pain that may have been caused by no fault of their own, but it is there, and they need victory over it. I have heard remarkable testimonies of how God has used CR in gaining healing in their lives, not because CR has some magic formula for healing, but because we simply do what Scripture tells us to do, foremost being keeping Christ in the center, and next is to love your brother and sister in Christ. You know, the Apostle Paul had a hurt that really bothered him, and he entreated the Lord 3 times to take it away, and I'm sure everyone is familiar with God's response in 2 Corinthians 12:9. Where he says, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness. And I love what Paul says next in the same verse. He says, most gladly, therefore, I would rather boast about my weaknesses that the power of Christ may dwell in me. You see, I don't mind telling you about my weakness toward alcohol. Not a bit. Because the power of Christ overwhelmingly conquers on this issue in my life. I've just finished my first step study in Celebrate Recovery, and I would like to put a plug in for the step studies. For me, it has been a tremendous opportunity for introspection and developing better insight into where I am in my walk with the Lord. The sometimes painful task of opening up my deepest scars was a little intimidating, I'll say that. But taking the risk of opening myself up to others in the step studies has reaped great rewards for me. I highly and greatly recommend taking a step study. It will change your life. I've been sober now going on 2.5 years. Don't want to drink. And with the power of Christ, I will never take a drink again. Although, when we do things like that, a lot of times we think back and think, how did I slip into that? You know, me as a Christian, I think of that. How did I slip into that? And we start beating ourselves up over it. But, you know, I heard Rick Warren on the radio the other day, and if you'd like to listen to the Bot Radio Network on 90.5, you'll hear different people, and Rick Warren is one of them. And he said something that sticks with me as I think back about my past issue with alcohol. He said, there is no saint without a past, and no sinner without a future. That's true. There is no saint without a past, and no sinner without a future. I look forward to my future in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. He has given me the victory in this issue, and I give glory to Him. On a personal note, I would like to say that when I received my first DWI, it was broadcast on the local media. My issue with alcohol was exposed. I remember receiving a call during that time from Jerry Waddle. He's a member of Linwood, telling me that he was praying for me. I do want to thank him publicly for that and remind everyone that the effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. Let us confess our sins and pray for one another. And I do have one request from you, my brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. In my time in alcoholism, I developed a tobacco habit. Something, ironically, I judged some Christians for in the past. It is a very difficult habit for me to break. And I do pray daily to get off the cigarettes. But I ask for your prayers on this issue. My name is Don. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. And I struggle with alcohol and insecurity and other things. Thank you for listening to what Christ has done in my life, and I hope to see you at Celebrate Recovery this Tuesday. Thank you.
Let's all stand together. What a beautiful way just to remind ourselves that we need to lean into Jesus. We need Him more than ever. We need His love.
And it overwhelms and satisfies my soul. I am healed.
How often, Lord, have we needed you and cried out, and maybe we felt like you weren't listening. Maybe we felt there was silence coming from the other side. But we can know this. You sent your Son, Jesus, to die for our sins. In the ultimate display of love, in the ultimate display of affection, in the ultimate display of your kindness and your redemption to us. So when we're praying and we're needing an answer from you, Lord, you've given us an answer. It's Christ. It's Jesus. We can go to you for that.
Thank you.
Father, how we praise you for the love that you have for us, a love that we don't deserve because of our sin. But yet out of your grace and mercy, you've extended that love to us through the love of Christ. Father, I pray that we'll understand not just that it saves us from sin, and it saves us so that we can go to heaven, but it saves us in such a way that we can experience joy and power in the midst of all that we're facing. Father, I pray that you'll help me share that truth this morning and accomplish your purpose in Christ's name. Amen. One of the things that I really love about pastoring is the body of Christ, is the family, is the local representation of the church. It's our church. It's Linwood. And the thing I love about it is the encouragement that you give me as I watch you respond to circumstances in life in such a way that it's painful, it's tragic, it's painful, it's hard, but yet you respond in such a way that is an encouragement to me. It's your ability to keep going with passion and joy. It's not that you just don't give up and quit. You know, people do that, and they disconnect from God in some form or fashion, but it's the ability to keep going, and yet you still have a desire to continue to follow Christ, and there's a sense of joy in you. Now, I love ministering to people. That's part of my responsibility. It's part of my calling. It's really part of who I am, of helping people, of serving people. Particularly in those times of crisis, I can get a call at any moment and I drop what I'm doing. And when I need to be there, I try to get there and to help. And so I love doing that, but you need to realize that you're doing the same thing to me without doing something personal in nature to me or for me. But it's the encouragement, again, that you give me and to others by watching you. Cliff and Sally Crosno, this morning Cliff prayed for our offering, and he said in the prayer that the message was particularly helpful for him because of what they're going through. Well, he just recently buried his daughter-in-law at an age that is younger than normal for someone to experience death, but because of illness that happened. And I could give you a myriad of examples, but the way that he prayed, you could sense that he was still pressing on and that he still had the joy of God in his heart, as painful as that is. And many of you could say the same thing because you've said it and I've seen you live that out. And what we're going to do is we're going to take time over the next several months to study the book of Philippians. Many see the book of Philippians, they will theme it as a book about joy, and it is that, but the joy is in the context of persevering. It's the joy that comes not just because I'm happy that I'm saved, and that I'm happy that maybe I have friends in the family of God and all the rest, but it's the encouragement that Paul writes to a church, a local body of believers, and he is thanking them for the joy that he has because of their faithfulness in the Lord. They have learned how to keep going, a very young church, but learning how to keep going in the midst of difficult times with passion and with joy. Now today, I want to begin by giving you some context concerning the city of Philippi and the church itself, and set it up really for next Sunday. I don't have time to preach everything that I had prepared today. You ought to be glad about that. I will tell Don that I do understand that statement, long sermons create a problem. So I'm going to just do a small part of it this morning and set it up, because what I want to do is I want to help you learn how to experience the joy of God in your life, particularly in the midst of the problems that you might be facing. So we're going to get to the text in a few moments. For those who are guests, this is not a typical sermon. because next Sunday you'll get a taste of a typical sermon where I work through the text, and I'll begin that next Sunday. But I need to give some background to set up the series that I'm going to be doing over the next several weeks. Now, when we look at the city of Philippi, it wasn't always known as that. It's in Greece that we know today. Then it was called Macedonia. And it was in the northeast part of that part of that region of Macedon or Macedonia. Today it's in the northern part of Greece. If you look at a map, you'll see that this area is sandwiched between Italy and Turkey. And it's on the coast, the very northern part of the Mediterranean Sea. It was a significant place later on in history. It was known as the Via Ignatia. It was a Roman highway that ran through Philippi, and so it was a strategic city. Now, in 536 BC, Philip of Macedon, who was the father of Alexander the Great, took over that region. He conquered that region primarily because of their gold mines, and he renamed the city, or the village, actually, Crenides. He named that after himself. He named it after Philip, Philip of Macedon the second. And so it became known as Philippi. In about the 2nd century B.C., we find that the Romans conquered Macedonia, taking over Philippi. And then in 43 B.C., there was a very significant battle that took place. At the time, in fact, it's one of the most significant of all of Roman history. It's the battle at Philippi. And what happened, you found that Antony and Octavian, who became known as Caesar Augustus. We're all familiar with that name, right? Caesar Augustus, Luke chapter 2. We find that he was a Roman general at the time, and he defeated Brutus and Cassius in this significant battle that took place. Now, when that happened, a couple of things resulted in that victory. First of all, we find that the Roman Republic basically ended and the Roman Empire began. If you read history, you'll understand the context of what happened. But a significant point changed in how Rome was ruled from a republic, and then it became more of an emperor being ruling the Roman Empire. Secondly, after the battle, Octavian and Antony had their army, the veterans of their army, settle in Philippi, which became a Roman colony. That meant that those who were living there, they were not subjects. They were not slaves. They were considered Roman citizens. So if you were part of a Roman colony, not every place that Rome conquered was considered a colony, then it was a significant and it was a place of blessing for you to live in that particular place. So that's true for that time of history. So we see the background of the city of Philippi. That's why it's called that. It's where it's located. Now, what we also find is that Paul, on his second missionary journey, established the first church there in that part of the world. He primarily ministered in Asia Minor, which we would consider Turkey, and along the Mediterranean coast. But when he came to Philippi, to Greece, it was the doorway to Europe. So the gospel made its way across the Mediterranean Sea from Jerusalem, and then he got into Europe, and it spread through Europe, eventually landing here in the United States. So we see the significance of this timing of his journey. Now, on Paul's second missionary journey, he was going and visiting other churches, but he was also collecting money for those who were in Jerusalem, the believers who were very poor. He was going to make his way while he was in Asia Minor, this area of Turkey. He was going to go to Ephesus, which is on the coast there. But in Acts chapter 16, we find that Luke writes about Paul having a vision before he makes his way to Ephesus. And in that experience, we find these words. During the night, a vision appeared to Paul. A Macedonian man was standing and pleading with him, quote, "Cross over to Macedonia and help us." After he had seen the vision, we immediately made efforts to set out for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to evangelize them. So we find that he's going now to Philippi, going to Macedonia. He would land in to Philippi, and there he was going there to establish the gospel, and he would start a church there, one of the first churches in his ministry. Now here we find that he goes into the town and there was no Jewish synagogue. Paul would always go into a synagogue and he would preach the gospel. He would talk about Jesus Christ. He would talk about his Jewish background. He had the perfect platform to be able to talk about Christ, how he was the Messiah. But here he goes into a town and there was no synagogue. And so he finds that there are some people praying outside near the city, and he meets a woman named Lydia. The Bible says that she sold purple cloth, meaning that she was a rather wealthy woman, and she came to faith in Jesus Christ, his first convert. And so after she came to know Christ, Paul and Silas are ministering there. They're preaching, they're performing miracles, and there is a demon-possessed slave girl who is following them and taunting them. And Paul turns around and he casts these demons out of her. And more than likely, she became a follower of Christ, which was common when that experience happened. Well, the owners of this slave girl were upset because she was a fortune teller and she made money for them. And so as a result, they had Paul and Silas arrested in Philippi. Now, you know the story, right? They're in prison. And what happens? How are they responding when things are not going well? They're singing hymns. They're praising God. They have God's joy. They keep going when it's in a bad situation, and they have great passion and joy. An earthquake happens. The ground shakes. The chains fall off. The door opens. They're getting ready to walk out. The Philippian jailer realizes that if they escape, he's going to die, and so he decides he's going to kill himself. Paul says, wait. Leads him to Christ, to faith in Christ. And these early disciples become the nucleus of this new church in Philippi. So about 51 AD, Paul establishes this church. Now, Paul is writing this letter to the church at Philippi for a couple of reasons. What happens now is that Paul is in prison in Rome. He has three missionary journeys. And while he is preaching in Jerusalem, he's arrested at the end of Acts chapter 25, 26. You see this happen. And so he's arrested for his faith, and he appeals to Caesar. And so when he appeals to Caesar, that means he has a direct shot to Rome. And he goes there, and he's going to appeal to Nero. He's going to share the gospel. God had promised that he would go to Rome. And so while he is there, he writes several letters. He writes Colossians, he writes Ephesians, he writes Philemon. Epaphroditus had come from the church at Philippi. He brings an offering to support Paul. That's how people were fed. That's how they were clothed. That's how people took care of them, that relatives or friends would come to the prison and take care of them. They wouldn't do that in the prison itself. And so he was under house arrest there. He was able to have people come visit him. Epaphroditus from Philippi comes, and he's bringing this gift offering. And so Paul is writing the letter to thank the church. The great joy that he gives them, that in spite of the suffering they face and the persecution they face, that they keep going with great passion and joy. So that's the setting for what takes place. And that is the theme. He's writing a letter and helping them and helping us understand how we can have joy in the midst of the battle, right? Now, what I want to do is I want to help us understand the difference between happiness and joy. When we talk about joy, if that's the theme, then what's the difference between the two? Well, happiness, first of all, is an emotion. That's the key word. Happiness is an emotion that comes and goes. And why am I happy? Well, I'm happy because of a positive experience or a positive circumstance. I got a new job. I'm happy. You should be happy, hopefully. You have a new job, all right? Or I'm in a relationship, and it's a good relationship. That makes me happy. So when I have a positive circumstance or a positive relationship, I have this emotion of happiness. My question is, what happens when you're in a bad circumstance or in a bad relationship? How do you respond? Are you happy? No, you're not happy. And you shouldn't be happy because that's not a happy moment. You have a bad experience, you're going to feel unhappy. If you have a bad experience and feel good, you need to come see me after the service, all right? We need to talk. That's not normal. That's not healthy. That's happiness. What is joy? Joy is a deep-seated conviction. It's a deep-seated confidence and trust in God regardless of the circumstances or the relationship. If it's good, I have joy. If it's bad, I have joy. When my daughter-in-law dies, that's not a happy moment. But I can still have joy. I have confidence in God. I can trust Him. Now that's why you encourage me. Is I see you go through things and I come home and I tell my wife, I don't see how they're doing it. Now I really know how you're doing it because I know the truth of God's Word. But from an existential standpoint, I don't understand that. I don't understand how you're experiencing this in life, but you still have God's joy. You can still love Him and serve Him and follow Him. And you can still accomplish the purpose that God has for your life. You don't quit. You don't give up on Him. And you don't have a stoic sense of responsibility as a Christian. I'll just tough it out. You know, sometimes we all have to do that. Sometimes I have said I just have to preach my way through it. Sometimes that's all I know to do in certain situations, in seasons of ministry. You just preach your way through it and let God's Word do its job. But you see, that's the joy. Now, my question for you today is, have you lost the joy? Have you lost the joy? And so what I want to do, continue by way of introduction, is I want to help you, but maybe there's some reasons why you've lost the joy in your walk with God. And John MacArthur gives a great list. I want to go through some of these about reasons why we lose the joy. And I think all of us will say, you know, I can see where I have lost the joy, or maybe there was a moment or a warning to you of watching what's ahead so you don't lose the joy, all right? First of all, you can lose the joy because of a false sense of salvation. You think you're saved. You think you're a follower of Christ. But down deep inside, there's real doubt. You're really not sure. And you're a religious person. You have a religious background. Maybe you grew up in the church. But there's something that's restless inside of you. You're not settled in your spirit. And you don't have joy. Because what happens is, that's the way Satan paralyzes you. You don't feel like sharing your faith because you're not confident of your faith. You don't feel like serving the Lord because you don't feel like you're worthy to serve the Lord. I don't know if I'm really saved or saved enough that God would use me. And so we don't have that joy in our heart. Let me ask it this way. If you died today, do you know for certain, do you have absolute confidence that you would spend eternity in heaven? If you answer, I hope so, I think so, I might, then more than likely, you don't have joy. And listen, you need to get that settled. A lot of people I talk to, that's how they answer that question. As I've shared before, John writes in 1 John 5:13, these things are written, the Bible's written, that you can know that you have eternal life. I don't have that confidence out of arrogance because of how good I am. I have confidence because of how good He is, how what a grace and great God that I have who put His Son on the cross to die for my sin. And He did the work of taking care of my sin problem. And so I have absolute confidence. There's nothing I can do other than receive that by faith and repent and turn from my sin and follow Christ. Even though I don't do it perfectly, I still have confidence that I'm saved, that I am a follower of Jesus Christ. And remember, as Paul said in Romans 6, now I don't sin more so I can have more grace. That means you don't understand what it's about, if that's your attitude. Well, I can do what I want to. God will forgive me. Then don't think you're a Christian because that's not the way it works. If you're truly saved, you're going to do everything you can not to do that, as Don said right here a few minutes ago. All right? So I'm saved by grace. I have that confidence. So this morning, you may be here, think you're a believer, or you may know that you're not. But if you don't have that assurance, then you're not going to have the joy that God wants you to have, all right? Now, that's for those who are non-believers. The rest of this list is for believers. Another reason that you might lose your joy is because of Satan and his demonic forces that are attacking you. You are weary in the battle, and Satan's come against you, and demonic forces have come against you. And for a lot of people, a lot of Christians, they don't understand that's what's happening right now. They don't understand that as a follower, particularly new Christians, you see, you're the most vulnerable because you once were in Satan's domain, now you're in God's domain, and he's not happy about that. And he's going to try everything he can do to discourage you and to defeat you and to make you convinced that it's not worth it. And that's why Paul gives us the tools that we need, particularly in Ephesians chapter 6. He says in verse 10, "Be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might, for our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the powers and the principalities of the air," etc. And then he talks about putting on the whole armor of God, putting on those spiritual pieces that we need in order to fight the enemy. Because listen, when you're in the midst of the battle and Satan's coming against you, it can be very discouraging. And we don't understand what's taking place. I need a series of messages just to talk about the spiritual battle, the spiritual warfare that we're in. But you see, that's what's going on. We're in a spiritual battle. And the Christian life is not about how comfortable you are, how good you feel. It's about fighting the enemy. It's about regaining the territory that the enemy has stolen in your life personally and as it relates to the culture that we live in. A third reason that we lose our joy is your failure to understand the sovereignty of God. And this is where Christians really have a hard time. Here's how this is demonstrated. Why does God let bad things happen to good people? You don't understand God's sovereignty. I don't deserve this. Well, that can mean a lot of things, but it can mean you don't understand God's sovereignty. Why is there evil and suffering in the world? That's the bigger question, the philosophical question. Well, we have to understand a part of God's sovereignty that he allowed sin to enter in the world because of the sin of Adam and Eve. And when they sinned, sin entered the world and corrupted everything. All right? And so what we fail is we fail to understand that God has allowed this particular event in my life. He could have kept it from happening, but he didn't. And the reason he didn't is that God is using this suffering in my life to teach me, to grow me, to mature me, to refine me, and to help me understand how his grace is sufficient in my weakness, that I need him. I can't trust in myself or anybody else. I don't have the power or the ability to do anything about it. But I learn that God is sovereign. I can trust him. So if I fail to understand that, I'm going to be in a miserable place. And if you fail to understand the sovereignty of God and what he's doing in the big picture of eternity and in your life specifically, then you're going to be a miserable person. You're going to lose the joy. All right? Another reason we lose the joy is because of prayerlessness. Prayerlessness. Now, why is that? You're not hearing God. I've lost the joy because God doesn't speak to me. I don't hear God. I don't sense God is active in my life. Well, if you're not praying, and I'm not just saying give him your list of what you want in your life, but I mean you're in seasons and in times. There's a closet time, and there's an attitude throughout the day. I want to hear God speak. I want to hear God. When I'm praying, I'm able to hear the Lord and then do what he tells me to do. You see, if I need to know what to do because of the circumstance I'm in, and I'm not praying, I'm not going to hear God, I can get real discouraged. I can lose the joy. So how's your prayer life? How's your prayer life? I don't want to sound legalistic. I'm not saying God's going to thump you if you miss a day of prayer in the closet. He's not that kind of God. But seriously, how's your prayer life? And if you're not praying, you will lose your joy. I promise you, you'll lose the joy. Another reason that we lose the joy is because of the emotional lows that come after spiritual highs. Read about Elijah. Elijah fights the prophets of Baal. It's a tremendous miracle that takes place as he prays and he asks God to solve this problem with Ahab, King Ahab, and Jezebel. And I'm telling you, boy, God does a number. It's a great miracle. Well, Elijah has this great victory, and then all of a sudden, Jezebel says, I'm going after Elijah. And we find him, the very next thing that he's doing, he's on the run. He runs out into the desert, and he finds a juniper tree, the Bible says, and he's sitting under the juniper tree complaining to God, and God asks, what are you doing here? Now think of it. He just defeated the prophets of Baal, and he's running from Jezebel. What happened? An emotional low after a spiritual high. Now that's how the enemy can work. Have you had that experience in your life? You've had just a great spiritual victory, and then it seems like within hours or days or weeks, all of a sudden you find yourself in despair. You find yourself, you've lost the joy. You're questioning God. Why is this happening? All right? So be aware. If you say, man, I'm on a spiritual high right now, or that's going to come later in your life, just be aware to know that something may happen where the enemy is going to try to rob you of your joy because of the spiritual high that you've experienced. Kids go to camp. How many of us been to camp? All right? And we come back from camp. Oh, we're on fire for God. We're going to win our school for Christ. And then somebody makes fun of us. First day of school. Somebody challenges our faith and we wilt away. And now we don't have the joy any longer. All right? We come to church on Sunday. God willing, we have a great experience. It's a spiritual high for us. And on Monday morning, we wake up. Oh man, I got to go to that job. We lose the joy, right? Spiritual high, emotional low. It can happen. When I was in high school, I just told somebody this recently. We moved to Clearwater, Florida. I was a junior in high school. I was excited about moving to Florida. But every night about 10 o'clock when I went to bed, I had a physical pain in my stomach. I'd wake up in the morning. Sometimes I'd throw up and I'd go to school. My first class was Bible. Public school taught Bible in Clearwater, Florida. And I thought, well, that'll make me feel better. It didn't. It was terrible. It was terrible. School, I'm telling you, man, it was a total culture shock in many ways. Our youth group, it was a culture shock. And the only thing that kept me going at that time was my family and playing football. And I'd have that high and that low, that high and that low. And looking back, I can really see how Satan played with me, trying to rob me of the joy. Another reason we lose the joy is focusing on our circumstances. That means, really, we dwell on the pain of the circumstances. And that's why Paul encourages us, don't think about the things that are below, but think about the things that are above. We're going to learn in Philippians how Paul encourages this church to forget what's behind and press on and keep their focus on Jesus Christ. It's going to be a great encouragement to us as we get to that passage later on. Another reason we lose the joy, this is so important, an ungrateful heart. An ungrateful heart. When's the last time you thanked God for your salvation? When's the last time that you thank God for what He's doing in your life right now? You thanked Him for your church, you thanked Him for your family, you thanked Him for another Christian who's been a great encouragement to you. Young people and all the millennials that are here, let me help you. Whenever somebody does something for you, write a thank you note. Handwritten, text and email doesn't cut it. That ain't going to work. Okay? Because somebody's going to say, well, what an ingrate. How unthoughtful. I did this for them and they didn't say thank you for what I did for them. When's the last time you wrote a thank you note to God in your heart? Maybe just sat down and wrote a letter to God. Actually write it and say, thank you, Lord. You see, I think of the children of Israel. God would do a miracle, and the next moment they'd be ungrateful. He'd do another miracle, meet that need, ungrateful. How, God, could you do this to us again? They'd gripe at Moses for, you know, what was going on. No manna, no water, whatever else. You brought us out here to die. It's just a picture of us, our hearts. And see, if we're not grateful, we're going to lose the joy. Another reason we lose the joy is forgetfulness. Go down memory lane. Remember. Go back and remember God's faithfulness in those seasons of your life that were challenging. Again, we focus on the moment, but stop and say, no, God's been faithful in the past. I went through this and He was there. I went through this and He was there. And I am here and He is here. He's going to help me. Another reason that we lose the joy is because of uncontrolled feelings. We can't stay in control of our emotions, our feelings. And we lose the joy. We say something or do something we didn't mean to say or do, right? Now, I want to talk about the root of that problem. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a pastor years ago, great, great quote. He says this, listen. I suggest that the main trouble in this whole matter of spiritual depression, lose the joy, is this. That we allow ourselves to talk to us instead of talking to ourselves. Have you realized that most of your unhappiness in life is due to the fact that you are listening to yourself rather than talking to yourself? The main art in the matter of spiritual living is to know how to handle yourself. Now that is a great quote. Let's be honest. Don't raise your hand, but how many of us, how much time do you spend listening to yourself talk to you? Telling you how bad a person you are. About how God doesn't love you and about you're not going to make it and you need to quit and give up and all the rest, all these things that yourself is talking to you. Remember 1 John 3:20. Though our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our hearts. And what do we need to be doing? We need to be speaking truth to ourselves. We need to be speaking the Word of God to ourselves. Not listening to what it's saying to us and about us, but reminding ourselves who we are in Christ, our position in Christ. I am a child of God. My sin is forgiven. God has made me holy and blameless and righteous before Him because of His righteousness, His holiness. He is blameless, as we're going to read next week. That's who I am in Christ. So I don't have to listen to the enemy. That's what we're really doing. The self, Satan is using the self in us to convince us of how bad a horrible person that we are. And it's all a lie straight from hell. Again, young people, listen. Listen to this. Don't let yourself convince you of lies about you. Go to God's Word and let Him speak to you that which is true about you. All right? And then, the last thing I'll say, another reason that we lose joy is because of an unwillingness to accept forgiveness. It goes in line to what I just said. Can I give you some good news? If you're in Christ, God has forgiven you of every sin that you've ever committed. Do you believe that? You are forgiven in Christ. Accept that forgiveness. Embrace that forgiveness. Because if you don't, you're saying that God did not do enough when He put Jesus Christ on the cross to die for my sin. There's something more that I have to do or that He has to do in order for my sin to be forgiven. Which is not true, is it? He's done it all. You're forgiven. So, what I want to do is I want to show you over the next several months how you can keep going with passion and joy. All right, that's the setup. I want you to come back. We'll get into the text, the beautiful text. In fact, can I do this? I can't go without reading the Bible. I'll lose my job if I don't do that right now. All right? though I've quoted some scriptures, let's look at Philippians 1. Let me just read it without comment, all right? Philippians 1, verse 1. Paul and Timothy, slaves of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who were in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, here's the heart of it, okay? Here's he's talking about the joy that they have and that he has. He's thanking them. I give thanks to my God for every remembrance of you, always praying with joy for all of you in my every prayer because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. I am sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Now, I have to say, that's the key verse in this whole passage. Great verse. We'll come to it next Sunday. It is right for me to think this way about all of you because I have you in my heart and you are all partners with me in grace, both in my imprisonment and in the defense and establishment of the gospel. For God is my witness how I deeply miss all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And I pray this, five things, that your love will keep on growing in knowledge and every kind of discernment, so that you can determine what really matters and can be pure and blameless in the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Amen? Now, there might be somebody here this morning who would say, Pastor, I don't have that joy because I don't have the assurance of my salvation. I don't have the assurance that I'm right with God. And today, I need to nail that down. I don't want to leave this place without knowing that I'm right with God. And we're going to help you do that this morning. In just a moment when we sing this next song, it's a time of response. It's an act of worship. And so when we sing, you'll just come forward and we'll help you with that commitment. Many of you in the room would say, Pastor, I know the Lord, but there's a place where my joy has been robbed. Now, I could have listed 20 other reasons why it's possible for you to lose your joy, right? But maybe one of those sparked something in you. God convicted you that, yes, this is a place where you've lost the joy. And maybe just right where you are, while we sing, you just tell the Lord that. He already knows it. But just tell the Lord, Lord, I know that this is the place where I've lost the joy. Help me get that joy back. What did David say in Psalm 51? After he had sinned with Bathsheba and killed her husband, Uriah, what did he say? Restore unto me the joy of your salvation. He'd lost the joy, and he prayed that God would restore it. And so maybe you've lost that, and ask God to restore that joy in you. There may be others that God wants you to be part of Linwood Baptist Church, a church that I believe demonstrates the joy of the Lord. People who really love him, are passionate about him, who demonstrate that joy in the midst of suffering and will be an encouragement to you in your suffering with the joy that they have. We invite you to come. Others may just need to come and pray or talk with somebody. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts this morning from your word, even just reading that passage a few moments ago. But also, Lord, in the context of what you're trying to say then and now, that we would learn how to receive your joy and maintain that joy, maintain the victory in our Christian walk. And God, I pray that you'll help these who are here this morning, others who need to be here, but help these who need to make commitments now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's quietly stand. While we sing this next song, we're inviting you to come as the Lord has spoken to your heart. I pray that you not wait, but as we begin to sing, that you'll come as God leads you right now. Thank you. Continue our worship now as we give to the Lord our tithes and offerings. For those who are guests, if you filled out a Connect card earlier, you'll want to place that in the plate as your gift to us this morning. Thank you again for being here to worship with us. For those who are members of the church, thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the Lord your tithes and offerings, as you so faithfully do, as we, like Paul, take these funds and use it to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ here and around the world. And so let's prepare our hearts as we do that now. And Josh, you come and lead us, please, sir. All right?
Dear Father in heaven, we come before you this morning, thankful that we could gather together, Lord. And thank you for sending your son, Lord. I'm so thankful for the joy that you've given us, Lord. I know my job in hospice, Lord, I see people who grieve without hope, and I see people who grieve with hope, Lord. And there's a big difference, Lord. We're thankful for the joy that you sent us, Lord. And I also pray for these tithes and offerings, that you'll multiply them just like you did the fish and the loaves, Lord, and use them for your glory. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you.
be seated, please. Very quickly, a couple of things I want to mention. Some months ago, I mentioned that we were going to be engaging in South Cape in some activities and ministries. One of those will take place May the 20th. It's on a Saturday. We're going to be hosting a picnic with a few others, but we're taking a big lead in this in several different ways. But I need your help. I need some folks to help me there on that day as we serve the food. We're cooking 3,000 hot dogs. We're expecting a big crowd. Listen, there's going to be a revival all week long, a tent revival that's going to be near Southside Baptist Church. It's going to be on the outside. It's mainly to reach that part of our community with the gospel and help bring churches in that area together. But I need your help on that day, and I'll give you more details later. I want you to save the date, May 20, all right? Leading up, there'll be a revival service each night. And then on Saturday will be the picnic and a block party. We'll be serving the food. And I need you there to help serve, to just mingle and get to know people and make it a community event and touch them with the love of Christ. Amen. And you, I know you can do that very well. Many of us have already been down there on several occasions. And so I hope that you'll join us in doing that, all right? Discover Linwood Lunch. If you've already signed up, then don't forget, we're going to have that next, all right? So make your way over to the Fellowship Hall. And then Michaela Butler, all right? Michaela, come stand up here next to me. Michaela is coming today, and she is going to be our new director of our preschool ministry. And she is coming to us from Ouachita Baptist University. She's going to be graduating in June. Or May, and then moving here in June. She's here this weekend to find a place to live and to check things out. Hopefully we didn't scare her too much today. Are you still going to do it?
As far as I know, yeah.
Okay, good. All right. And so she comes. She's got great experience in working with preschoolers and with children, and she's doing that currently and in the past at her home church in Arkansas. So that's okay. My wife's from Arkansas,
right.
So I have to say that. We're glad that you're here, and let's welcome Michaela, all right? Now, she'll be moving here in June, so today is not official or anything, but she's going to be with us over in the luncheon, too. So, Michaela, thank you. I'll let you have a seat, all right, or head where you need to. All right, let me introduce these who've come. Sharon Hodges, come stand here next to me, Sharon. Sharon's been visiting our church for some time. She knows the Lord, has already followed through with baptism, and wants to unite with our church family. And, Sharon, we're so delighted that God has brought you here to Linwood to fellowship with us and to serve the Lord together with us. And then Eddie and Gretchen Donovan, if you'll stand here next to me. Many of you know this dear couple, Gary and Janelle Reitzel. This is their daughter and son-in-law. And so I've known these guys for many years and know Gretchen's brother better, who is from Cape as well. Many of you know Brent. And so we come today to let you know about them being a part of our church. They know the Lord. They've also followed through with baptism, and they desire to be a part of what God's doing here. And if you rejoice in these commitments today, would you join me by saying amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. You'll want to come by and introduce yourself to these who've come today. And again, guests, so thankful that you're here. If I've not met you personally, would love to do so out in the foyer right after the service. All right? May God richly bless you with the joy of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
All right.